Like the black-robed preachers of the 18th century, Dan is a pastor who boldly proclaims the principles of liberty from the pulpit. As a leader of the modern-day black-robed regiment, Dan is a pastor of Liberty Church in Yukon, Oklahoma, convinced that pastors have a biblical mandate to be salt and light to their culture. Dan also served 2 terms in the Oklahoma House of Representatives while remaining a full-time pastor. By retelling the story of the Black Regiment, Dan hopes to re-educate and mobilize today's preachers to engage in America's culture war, just as the Patriot pastors did in the 1700s. Dan and Percussion Films produced the 90-minute docudrama video Bringing Back the Black-Robed Regiment, which tells the amazing story of the daring deeds of these original Patriot pastors who stood against British tyranny. The rewritten second edition of the accompanying book by the same title is also available. It documents the story of the Black Regiment with over 600 footnotes and over 100 sources in its bibliography. Now, sit back and prepare to travel back with us to a time when the American church stood up for what it believed in as Dan Fisher presents Bringing Back the Black-Robed Regiment.
Blessed be the Lord, my strength, which teacheth my hands to war, my fingers to fight. My goodness, my fortress, my high tower, my deliverer, and my shield. Our muskets leaning against the back wall speak as loudly as anything I might say this morning regarding our present crisis. Today we are called upon to either surrender our liberties, our religion, and our country, or to defend them at the point of the sword. There's no other choice. As we who would gladly live peaceably among all men, we're now compelled to fight. It is therefore, my brethren, an indispensable duty that we owe to God and our country to rouse up and bestir ourselves and being animated with a noble zeal for the sacred cause of liberty, to defend our lives and our fortunes to the shedding of the last drop of blood. We must turn our plowshares into swords and our pruning hooks into spears and learn the art of self-defense against our enemies. Now, there are some who pretend it's against their conscience to take up arms in defense of their country. But can any rational being suppose that God requires us to contradict the laws of self-defense which He, God Himself, has written in our hearts? To be careless and remiss, or to neglect the cause of our country, will expose us to the displeasure of Almighty God. To save our country from the hands of our oppressors ought to be dearer to us than our lives. And next to the eternal salvation of our souls, it is the thing of greatest importance. A duty so sacred, it cannot be dispensed with for the sake of our secular concerns. The cause of virtue and freedom is the cause of God upon earth. To indulge cowardice in such a cause, it argues a want of faith in God. And he that is so lost to humanity as to be willing to sacrifice his country for the sake of avarice or ambition has arrived at the highest stage of wickedness that human nature is capable of. He deserves a much worse name than I at present care to give him. But I think I may with propriety say that such a person has forfeited his right to human society. The love of our country the tender affection we have for our wives and our children do now loudly call upon us to use our best endeavors to save our country. Either surrender liberty or defend it. It is your choice.
See your hands, little girl.
Dear congregation, I've been your pastor a good number of years. But the time has come for me to fight the good fight on a different battlefield. To defend liberty, both yours and mine. It is the right thing to do. And if I fall in the fight, I hope to see you someday in a land where the shadow of death will never again fall upon us. And liberty is eternal. Men, who will go with me?
There was a time when the church in America was the tip of the spear. We led out in the fight for truth and liberty. I was one of those preachers. What you just saw was what it was like to be in one of our churches in the 18th century, pastored by a patriot pastor preacher. Well, I pastored in Woodstock, Virginia, grew up in Pennsylvania. My name is John Peter Gabriel Muhlenberg. Now that's kind of a long name, so you can just call me Peter. My enemies called me Devil Pete, because when I was a little younger, I had a pretty fiery temper. Like I said, I was a pastor. I grew up a Lutheran. I pastored in Woodstock, but in Virginia in those days, if you wanted to pastor there, you had to be an Anglican. So I traveled to Europe, ordained as an Anglican preacher, but I was Lutheran through and through. I preached these principles of justice and proper government, and preached against tyranny from my pulpit, just like preachers did in my day all over the colonies. Now, we didn't want to fight, but when the fight came, we were ready to do our duty. Now, I don't know what preachers look like in your day, but in my day, when we pastors climbed up into our pulpits, we always wore our black robes, and it didn't matter whether you were Baptist or Lutheran or Presbyterian or Anglican. You'd always preach in a black robe. Now, I know, you're wondering about the uniform. I'll tell you about that in a moment. So we'd get up in front of our people, and we'd wear our black robes, so we'd look just like this. Now, I don't know if your preachers in your day preach in black robes, but this is how we looked in my day. And then we would also wear what we called our preaching bands, which were really just scarves that we would fold like so, and we would wear around our necks. And this is how the typical pastor in my century looked. Now, I don't want you to get the wrong idea that we weren't committed to the gospel. Oh, we preached the gospel strong and bold. We didn't believe in, what is it that you have, political correctness. We were only concerned about biblical correctness. And this business of separation of church and state, I don't even know what that is, but we didn't believe in it in my day. We didn't just preach the gospel, though, because we found tucked away in God's word much about proper government and justice. And like I said, tyranny. We preached against those things as well. Now, I know some of you are probably under the mistaken notion that we fought our little war of independence because of excessive taxation. Oh, and I will admit, taxation without representation. That was a familiar phrase in my day. We found the tea tax to be particularly onerous, and it caused my friends to throw a little tea party down in the Boston Harbor, if you know anything about that. Oh, but make no mistake about it, my friends. We were fighting against what we believe was tyranny. And we knew that tyranny, unchallenged and unchecked, would ultimately come to our churches and tell us how we could live, what we could believe, and what I could preach. We weren't going to have it. And so when the time came, as much as we tried to avoid it and war broke out, we preachers were proud to do our part. Now, like many preachers in my day, I was also engaged in government. I served in the Virginia House of Burgesses before old King George shut it down. I served there with some fine Virginians. You might recognize a gentleman farmer by the name of Mr. Washington and the finest Christian orator I've ever known, Patrick Henry. I was there the day in Richmond he gave that speech, "Give me liberty or give me death." Well, I rode back to my church in Woodstock and I realized that I had to take a stand. Liberty was worth standing for. So I announced to my church January the 21st, 1776, as my final sermon as their pastor. My great-nephew, Henry Augustus Muhlenberg, wrote the account in 1849. You might want to check it out. Came my time to preach. I stood up and I opened up to the third chapter of Ecclesiastes. There's a time for all things, Solomon said. But verse 8 says, there's a time of war and a time of peace. That was my focus. Well, I closed my Bible and I climbed down out of my pulpit and I said, ladies and gentlemen, Solomon was right. There is a time to preach and there is also a time to pray. But sometimes there is a time to fight. And that time has now come, at least for me. Now, my people were accustomed to my being a pretty bold soldier in the army of the Lord, but I wasn't quite certain they were prepared for the sight that they were about to see, because I stepped off to the side and I removed my preaching bands. And then I removed my clerical robe to reveal the colonel's uniform that you saw a moment ago. See, Mr. Washington and Mr. Henry had recommended that I be commissioned as a colonel of a brand new regiment forming in Virginia. It would be the 8th such regiment out of our colony. And I was proud to lead those men. Now, I had positioned a drummer boy outside my church, and I told him that when I opened the doors of my church, that was the signal for him to begin to roll on that drum And he did. And then I turned around to my men with my sword and I said, "Men, you know me to be a man of peace, but sometimes truth and liberty must be defended, if necessary, at the point of a sword. Who will go with me?" Well, to my great delight, my congregation stood and began to sing that old Martin Luther hymn, "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God." And if you can believe it, one by one, the men of my church began to walk down the aisle of my little log church outside to sign the muster roll of the 8th Virginia, right beneath my name where I had signed it. Now, as I told you, we're with the 8th Regiment. I was privileged to lead those men all the way through the war from 1776 to 1783. We were engaged in most of the major battles of the war. You might say that I laid aside my preaching robe to wear a set of riding spurs because we were a cavalry unit. We were there at Yorktown. We helped to force the surrender of Cornwallis, which ultimately led, of course, to our victory and our independence. A famous painter of my day, Mr. John Trumbull, painted that surrender ceremony. I hear that it hangs in your Capitol Rotunda today in Washington, D.C. Well, if you look at that painting, you notice to the right there are a number of us gents on horses. And if you really zero in, you almost have to close one eye and squint the other, you can look and there I am, Lutheran Anglican preacher, now promoted to Major General Peter Muhlenberg. You have something in your Capitol building that you call Statuary Hall, where every state gets to honor two of its favorite sons and daughters. My home state of Pennsylvania chose me as their honoree. There I stand in marble today in your Capitol with my sheathed sword to my left, but notice flowing back over my right arm and behind me, the robe that I laid aside to lead the 8th. Now, I don't want you to get the wrong idea that it was just a handful of us hothead preachers. Oh, no. There were preachers from every denomination. In fact, in my day, I don't know what it's like in your day, but in my day, the Presbyterians were the fiery preachers. Oh, James Caldwell from Elizabethtown, New Jersey, was just one such preacher. He also was among our band. Now, many of us believe that old Caldwell said things just to make the British mad on purpose. Like he'd say, "Sometimes it is as righteous to fight as it is to pray." Well, if he meant to make the British mad, he succeeded. They put a bounty out on him. So every Sunday, Caldwell would walk into his pulpit wearing a couple of loaded flintlock pistols like this, hooked in his belt. He'd step up into the pulpit, take out his pistols, lay them down, preach his sermon. I've often said a preacher standing in the pulpit with a couple of loaded flintlock pistols and he takes an offering, I guarantee you, you're giving something, right? Your pastor might want to try that today. That technique works pretty well. Well, Caldwell and his wife were committed to the cause of liberty, but unfortunately the British were serious. When they invaded Elizabethtown, can you believe it? One of the redcoats jumped over the fence of the Caldwell home, saw Hannah Caldwell through the window, shot her, killed her instantly in cold blood. Preacher Caldwell heard about it, helped to eulogize his wife. Then he left the children in care of some friends in the town and rode off to Springfield, New Jersey, because there they were engaging the British again. Now, as he arrived, his men were yelling out for help. "We're out of wadding. Give us wadding for our muskets." Now, these muskets were fine fighting weapons, but without the wadding to push down the barrel to hold the shot tight, they were rendered relatively ineffective, useless. So what were they going to do? Well, old Caldwell knew what to do. He jumped on his horse, and he rode down to the First Presbyterian Church of Springfield, New Jersey, ran inside, and began to gather up Isaac Watts hymnals filled with songs written by our famous hymn writer, Isaac Watts. We sang them. Maybe you know some of them in your day, "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross." That's a Watts hymn. Now, what's old preacher Caldwell going to do with all these hymn books? Well, he rides back to his men, begins to throw the hymn books out at his men, saying, "Men, tear out the pages and use the pages for wadding." So get this mental picture. Here's preacher Caldwell throwing out Isaac Watts hymnals. His men are tearing out hymns, stuffing them down the barrels of their muskets, firing away at the British, and all the while he's yelling, "Give them Watts, boys. Put Watts into them." That's the Presbyterian preacher, James Caldwell. Sad fact, though, about old Caldwell. A man that we believe the British paid to assassinate him killed him about a year later. Terrible price he and his wife both gave for liberty. Now, I'm here to tell you that a lot of us paid a very high price. Let me tell you about a young preacher named Joab Trout. He was only 25. Let's see, when was it? September 77. Must have been September the 10th, 1777. We were camped on the banks of the Brandywine Creek. And we're on one side. The British are on the other. We know there's a fight coming for sure. Well, General Washington asked this 25-year-old preacher to preach a sermon to kind of buck up the courage of the boys. Now, the sun was starting to set, so he's going to have to hurry and preach a short sermon, which he did. Very powerful. Then he closed with this amazing prayer, and the final words of his sermon were, "And God prosper the cause." Well, we were ready to fight the British right then and there, I'll tell you. But the sun had just about set. The fighting would have to wait. But the very next day, September the 11th, 1777, we fought the British at the Battle of Brandywine. And that young preacher that had preached that sermon the night before, old Trout, he was right there with the rest of us. He died that day fighting for liberty so that he, I, and you could be free. So you see, when Mr. Jefferson and his committee wrote our Declaration of Independence, and in that declaration they said that we're willing to pledge our lives and our fortunes and our sacred honor, those were more than just words to us. We meant them, and we were ready to back them up with actions. Now, I got to tell you that old King George just could not stand us preachers. Oh, he hated us. In fact, he said, "Why, this is nothing more than a Presbyterian rebellion." The son of the British Prime Minister, Horace Walpole, he told Parliament, "There's no use in crying about it. Cousin America has eloped with a Presbyterian parson," which we thought was kind of funny. They're blaming all the British for the fight. Now, you may be wondering, where did the title Black-Robed Regiment come from? Well, it came from an American who was a British sympathizer, Peter Oliver. He was a Tory. And yet he came up with the title, and I believe it's a badge of honor that any Christian or preacher ought to wear today with great pride. Now, some of you may be saying, "Well, I've never heard anything about you preachers." Well, I'm here to tell you there's a lot of your history you haven't been told. Let me illustrate. It was April the 18th, 1775. There are a number of riders riding out across the Massachusetts countryside. They're yelling, "The regulars are out! The regulars are coming!" One of them's named Revere, Paul Revere. You might know a little about him. But did you know that when he rode into Lexington, he rode up to that house? That's where the preacher lived. Jonas Clark lived there. With the help of a deacon named John Parker, they'd been training the men of the church and the community how to fight together as soldiers. The night that Revere rides up, Preacher Clark has two special guests staying with him, Samuel Adams, John Hancock. John Hancock's grandfather had pastored that very church before. Well, they have a little council of war, and they ask old Preacher Clark, "Will the men fight?" He said, "I trained them for this very hour. They will fight, and if need be, die too, under the shadow of the house of God." So the very next day, April the 19th, 1775, Preacher Jonas Clark, Deacon John Parker, led some 77 Lexington men out to face, if you can believe it, almost 800 redcoats, outnumbered 10 to 1. Well, one of the British officers must have discharged his pistol because the redcoats took it as a signal to open fire, and the Battle of Lexington was on, and our War of Independence had begun. A battle, it was really nothing more than a skirmish. It lasted for 15 or 20 minutes. But when the smoke had cleared and the dust had settled, 8 of those men of Clark's church and community had done just what their preacher had said they would do. They had died right underneath the shadow of the church house. Another 10 had been wounded. How fitting is it that our first shots fired in our War of Independence were fired by Americans led by a preacher and a deacon fighting it out on the churchyard? Because that's exactly what happened. Now, that afternoon, the British went on over to Concord, and they were going to confiscate arms there. Well, when they got there, they didn't find any of those, but up on the hill, Barrett's Hill, was the colonial militia. And if you can believe it, there's another preacher there, William Emerson. He lived just a few hundred yards from the old North Bridge. In fact, his grandson, the famous poet Ralph Waldo Emerson, wrote the famous Concord hymn where it talks about the shot heard round the world. Well, what's old preacher Emerson doing? He says to the militia, "Men, stand your ground. If we're going to die, let's die here." Well, eventually the militia came down off the hill and they fought those redcoats down there at that old North Bridge and gave them a licking for sure, if you want to know the truth of it. So they began to retreat back to Boston. Unfortunately for them, lining the road were Minutemen groups led by preachers, and other groups, preachers were in the mix, and they began to fight, and they fought the British 17 miles from the Old North Bridge all the way back to Boston. In fact, I hear tell that they've preserved that road, and you can even walk it today. It's called Battle Road. So you see, the church was there front and center at the very first of the struggle. Well, just a few weeks after that, up in June, there was a fight outside of Boston. I believe you call it Bunker Hill. It was actually fought on Breed's Hill and Bunker Hill. That painter, Mr. Trumbull, painted a moment in that battle when General Warren was killed. Sad day for us. But if you'll notice up here in this section of the painting, there's a gentleman standing among arms. And if you look closely, you'll notice that he's wearing preaching bands. Well, that's because that's preacher Samuel McClintock. You see, Trumbull knew that preachers were there fighting. He knew the role that the church played. And old McClintock was there defending his liberty. By the time the war was over, he and his family had sacrificed 3 of their 4 sons. He wasn't the only preachers there. David Avery was there. See, we preachers, when the fighting commenced, we were right there in the mix. We weren't hiding out somewhere behind a rock. In fact, in his journal, he tells us he was standing out front where his men could see, musket balls whizzing all around, praying for God to give them the victory. Here's old Naphtali Daggett. He was a preacher, president of Yale. When the British invaded New Haven, Connecticut, you know what he did? About 100 of the boys, and he went out and fired a number of shots at the British to slow their advance. Sadly, though, they captured old Daggett, and they beat him so cruelly that he died a year later from his wounds. He never recovered. John Adams, a preacher from Durham, New Hampshire, he and the men of his church went out before the war ever got started and hid all the ammunition. I'm told he hid the gunpowder under his pulpit. So every Sunday, he's preaching these fiery sermons, standing on hundreds of pounds of gunpowder. Well, it's a wonder one of those fiery sermons hadn't made a spark, blown the church sky high. But I hear your modern preachers and their watered-down sermons wouldn't be in any danger whatsoever. They couldn't make a spark if you doused them with kerosene and threw a torch on them. Did not we preachers of my day? Oh, no. Oh, no. We preached boldly and strongly. We weren't afraid. I could tell you about old John Treadwell. He was from Lynn, Massachusetts. He kept a flintlock like this in his pulpit. This flintlock here was used by Lieutenant William Perkins at the Battle of Bunker Hill. It's a 78 caliber. Well, it was in the pulpit. And he would walk up to the pulpit, and I'm told he would have his Bible under one arm and his cartridge box under the other because he didn't know which one he'd need first. Jonathan French, when he heard about the Battle of Bunker Hill, why, he left his church, went back to his house, got his flintlock and his medical bag, joined the Continental Army. I could tell you story after story like this. But we were a bold group. This is a drawing of old John Cleveland, the pastor of Ipswich, Massachusetts. See, King George had made the British general Thomas Gage, well, if you ask me, the dictator of Massachusetts. And since they blamed the war on preachers, he didn't make it very easy on old Cleveland. So he wanted to write a letter of protest. But how's he going to do it? And then he landed on the idea, I'll print it in the newspaper. That way everybody can read it. Here's a little flavor of that letter. General Gage, thou profane, wicked monster of falsehood. Your late infamous proclamation is as full of notorious lies as a toad or rattlesnake of deadly poison. You, sir, are an abandoned wretch. Without speedy repentance, you will have an aggravated damnation in hell. I've often said, Preacher Cleveland, tell us what you really think, right? But you see, he didn't care. You know why? Because to us in my day, there were some things more important than comfort and approval. Things like honor, truth, and liberty. There were some things worth standing for, some things worth fighting for. And fight we did. Now, it wasn't just Lutherans and Presbyterians. The Baptists got in on it. Charles Thompson from Warren, Rhode Island. When the British invaded Warren, he joined the Continental Army as a chaplain. Unfortunately, he was captured, and they threw him on a prison ship. Oh, these were terrible places. Those soldiers faced a fate that, if you ask me, was worse than death itself. Almost 12,000 of our patriots died on those prison ships. Highest death rate was among preachers. Moses Allen was one of those preachers. He dove overboard trying to swim to safety, but underestimated how weakened he had become. And he couldn't swim. He didn't have the strength. You know what the British did? They just stood there and watched while he drowned. Then threw his body up on the bank to decay out there within sight of the ship. They hated They hated us preachers. Joab Houghton was from Hopewell, New Jersey, pastor of First Baptist. Like me, he climbed up through the ranks, was promoted, and when the war was over, he did not disengage. He then became a legislator. 4 days after Lexington and Concord, the word reached New Jersey. Well, Houghton stood on this rock right here. It's the top of a memorial today. In those days, it was in front of his church. And here's what he said to the men of his congregation. Men of New Jersey, the redcoats are murdering our brethren in New England. Who follows me to Boston? I'm told that every man in Houghton's church went home and got his flintlock, followed their preacher off to fight for liberty. During that terrible winter of 1777 and 78, when we were freezing and starving to death at Valley Forge, it was the ministry of preachers like me and old Houghton that helped to hold that army together so we could fight again that next spring. If you ever go to Valley Forge, well, you can tour, I'm told, the reconstructed Muhlenberg Brigade Barracks where my men and I spent that terrible, terrible winter. Now, we were fighters for sure, but none stronger than this man right here. This is Thomas Allen, the pastor from Pittsfield, Massachusetts, the chaplain and the commander of the Berkshire Militia. On August the 16th, 1777, he was front and center at the Battle of Bennington, Vermont. He led his men out onto the battlefield wearing his preaching robe. Then he walked out toward the British into the killing zone, jumped up on a stump, and gave them the opportunity to surrender before the battle ever started. Well, they fired a number of shots at him, and thankfully, they missed him, but one of the shots put a hole in his hat. So he walked back to his brother Joseph, and he said, Joe, I'm a better shot than you. You load and I'll shoot. And he and his brother fought all day long together, side by side at the Battle of Bennington, Vermont. After the battle, they helped to care for the wounded. And then toward the end of the week, why, Allen had to jump on his horse and ride the some 30 miles back to his church so he could preach. When he got there, one of the men from his church accosted him and said, Preacher! I heard the other day you fought like a common soldier. What's gotten into you? He said, well, every man had to do his duty. He said, but you're a preacher. Did you kill anybody? And Allen said, well, I don't know if I killed anybody, but I did notice behind a particular bush there was a frequent flash. And every time that flash occurred, one of our men would fall. I took steady aim and shot at that bush. I don't know if I killed anybody, but I can tell you this, I put out that flash. And that's Pastor Thomas Allen. We were indeed men who believed in something very strongly. Now, you may be saying, well, where in the world did you guys come from? Well, you see, a few years before the Declaration of Independence and our war began, there was a great revival that swept through the churches and the colonies. I believe your historians call it the First Great Awakening. Preachers like Jonathan Mayhew, Jonathan Edwards, George Whitefield were preaching powerful sermons, and many of us black robe guys were just boys in those days, and we grew up on that kind of preaching. So when the time came to fight for liberty, we were ready. We were ready. And we took our stand. Now, before I'm finished with my part of this presentation this morning, you need to know that I was not the only Muhlenberg in my family who was a preacher. My father, Henry, helped to found the Lutheran Church in Pennsylvania, and I had a number of other brothers, and one of them was named Frederick. Frederick was a preacher in New York City. I called him a fancy pants preacher, and he said to one of my other brothers that I shouldn't be involved in politics and war. Well, I got to tell you, I took offense at that. And so I shot a letter off to old Frederick, and I let him know a thing or two. In fact, let me, if you would just allow me, I want to read to you a section of that letter that I wrote to Frederick. I began by saying, now, Frederick, I am a clergyman, it is true, but I am a member of society as well as the poorest layman, and my liberty is as dear to me as to any man. Shall I then sit still and enjoy myself at home while the best blood of the continent is spilling? Why, heaven forbid it. Now, do you think, if America is conquered, that I'll be safe? Well, far from it. And would you not sooner fight like a man than die like some dog? Why, I am called by my country to its defense. And the cause is just and noble. And so far am I from thinking that I am wrong. I am convinced it is my duty so to do. A duty I owe to my God and to my country. Take that, Frederick. Well, do you think that caused my brother to see the light? Well, I don't know. But he soon felt the heat because not long after that, the British invaded New York City. And when they did, they came in there burning and desecrating churches. And my brother Frederick barely got out of there alive with his family. Now what does my fancy pants preacher brother have to say for himself? Well, immediately he joined the Continental Congress. Then he became a member of the Pennsylvania House of Representatives. And my brother, who said that preachers shouldn't get involved, became the first Speaker of the House of the United States of America and was one of the original signers of the Bill of Rights. Quite a turnaround, wouldn't you agree? Now, I know you may be thinking, well, Peter, it had to be your example that changed your brother, right? Wrong. See, I think old Frederick got pinched so hard that it hurt. And he almost waited too long. Here's my question to your generation. How long are you going to wait? And how hard will you have to be pinched before you finally find something worth standing and fighting for? Will you just roll over on everything? How hard will you have to be pinched? Folks, I've been a pastor practically all of my adult life. I started preaching when I was 16. By the time I was 24, I was a full-time pastor. I'm 58, so I've been a full-time pastor now for 34 years. Majority of my life, I didn't hear about guys like this. I didn't know about Peter Muhlenberg. I didn't know about Jonas Clark. I didn't know about any of these guys. I didn't know that preachers like old William Smith here said that our religious and civil rights are linked together in one indissoluble bond. I didn't know that. I didn't know that the church was the tip of the spear. I didn't know that preachers like old John Witherspoon, who was a Presbyterian, was the president of Princeton. I didn't know that he said there's not a single instance in history in which civil liberty was lost and religious liberty preserved entire. See, we need to put to bed the idea that we just won't be engaged, but we'll at least be safe here in our churches. Friends, our liberties are all woven together, and you start losing one, eventually you lose them all. They're all connected. In fact, I've come to find that our liberties, like a railroad track, have two rails. One rail is called civil liberty, the other religious liberty. And as long as those two are held secure, the train of state can move right along and we can enjoy our liberties. But you let one of those be given up, my friends, and the train runs off the tracks. Look around you. That's what's happening today. We're losing our liberties. And before we know it, if we don't do something, we're going to lose it all. Historians knew about the role the church played. Look here, in 1862, Frank Moore says that the preachers of the Revolution did not hesitate to attack the great political and social evils of their day. Today, most pastors won't touch them with a 10-foot pole. 2 years before that, John Thornton said, the fathers of the Republic did not divorce politics and religion, and they denounced the separation as ungodly. That's the exact opposite of what we're told today. Separation of church and state. Separation of church and state. That's what we hear constantly. The late Baptist preacher from Memphis, Tennessee, Adrian Rogers, said, God conceived and created human government. It's therefore inconceivable that he would create government and tell his people to stay out of it. It's exactly what we've been doing. Friends, we're salt and light. And where there is no salt, there's decay. Where there is no light, there's darkness. We all talk about politics being dirty. Of course it is. Christians abandoned it. And so now we're ruled by those who do not have a biblical worldview. The results? Predictable. In 1930s, in Germany, the church was silent while the Nazis were rising to power. In fact, the church was trying to strike up allegiances and some type of relationship with the Nazis, thinking that if they could stay neutral, everything would work out. Well, how did that work out? Oh, there were some who were shining the light, men like Dietrich Bonhoeffer, the Lutheran preacher, but he paid with his life. See, what happened in Germany is the church just waited too long. Is that what we're going to do? Or we're just going to wait too long? Samuel Adams once said this, if ever a time comes that vain and aspiring men possess the highest seats in government, our country will stand in need of its most experienced patriots to prevent its ruin. Friends, I'm telling you, he's talking to us. We must lead. Out of all people on this earth, those of us who've been set free by the blood of Jesus ought to appreciate liberty most of all. And yet the church today is bringing up the caboose, if we're even on the tracks at all. It's time for us to stand. In 2014, the Christian pollster George Barna was asking pastors why they won't preach on controversial passages of Scripture. They said, well, we're not going to touch them. He said, but why? There were two reasons that the pastors gave that kept rising to the top. The first reason was, we're afraid that it'll hurt our attendance. The second reason they gave is, we're afraid it'll hurt the size of our offerings. Friends, Jesus didn't die for either one of those. We are called to preach the truth and to live the truth and to defend the truth no matter the cost. Is there anything that you're willing to stand and fight for? See, it's time. It's time. Now, some of you are saying, well, Dan, are you calling for a modern-day black regiment? You want us to go home and get our guns and start shooting at government agents? Well, no, but I am calling for a modern black regiment. It's time for the church to rise up. If the church of the 18th century hadn't done it, we wouldn't even know the freedoms we know today. So what would a modern black regiment look like? What would they be talking about? Well, they'd be talking about many things, but here's one I guarantee you they'd be talking about. You know, since 1973, we have murdered over 60 million unborn babies in this country. Right here in Oklahoma, every business day we murder almost 20. That's practically, well, more than 5,000 every year. Well, I served a couple of terms in our legislature, and here's what I discovered about our government here in Oklahoma. All they want to do is regulate it. They don't want to end it. Friends, it is time to end this. In fact, it is time to abolish abortion in Oklahoma. We must stop this. It is time. And here's the incredible thing. The church can do it. We can do it. But if we don't, we're sinning. James 4:17, if you know to do good and you don't do it, you've sinned. And if we don't, these little lives are just going to keep being snuffed out. This is why, even though I'm a full-time pastor, after having served two terms in the legislature, I'm running for governor. I'm not going to quit preaching. People said, what are you going to do? I said, I'll be the preachingest governor this state's ever had. It's time for all of us to take our stand. Now, we're at the end today. So I want to close with one last story. I want you to put on your cap and I want you to travel back in time with me to the 18th century one last time. We're going to go to the Garden State of New Jersey, rural New Jersey. You say, well, where are we going in New Jersey? Well, we're going to go to a place where a preacher by the name of John Rossbrug lived. He lived in a little community called the Forks of the Delaware. He lived in that house right there. We don't have a portrait of John, but we do have one of his son, James. And so, assuming that James looks like his father, that's the closest we're going to get to knowing what John looked like. Now, he was not regular military like Peter Muhlenberg a while ago that I talked about. No, he was a civilian preacher. So he'd have worn civilian coat instead of a colonel's uniform. And instead of wearing a military tricorn hat like this, he would have worn a parson's hat. He would have looked something like this. I had been preaching these principles from my pulpit for years. I'd been preaching justice and proper government, and I'd been railing against the British and the tyranny that they had thrown upon the colonies. But you see, when the war started, I was 63. I was just a little too old to go off to fight. So I made a deal with the young men. I said, if you will go and fight, I will protect your families while you're away. Well, that worked pretty well until the Battle of Long Island, New York. And at the Battle of Long Island, New York, the British just rolled over General Washington and our boys. It was then that I realized that every able-bodied man was going to have to do his duty. So I called together the remaining men of my church. And I said, men, we must rally to the aid of General Washington and to truth and to liberty. They said, preacher, we'll go if you will lead us. I said, it would be my distinct honor. So, at the age of 63, I saddled up and rode off with my men to fight the British. And we joined General Washington's army and we fought at the Battle of Trenton, New Jersey. Many don't know, but about a week later, the Hessians and the British tried to retake Trenton at what we call the Second Battle of Trenton. And during that fight, I became separated from our men by a creek and I was trapped over with the British. I was on horseback, but I knew if I tried to cross that creek during the daylight, they'd kill me for sure. So I thought I'd just ride, evade capture when the sun set, then I'd cross in the dark. Well, late that afternoon, I had not had a drink of water, not a piece of bread or anything to eat. So I rode up to a tavern, went in hoping to find something. I tied off my horse. When I came back out, lo and behold, my horse was gone. Well, hoping that he had just pulled free, I began to walk through the trees and through the brush, trying to find him. And I pushed through a particularly thick group of bushes, only to step through onto the other side and find that I was surrounded by a group of Hessian soldiers. These Hessians were from Germany. They were mercenaries, merciless men on the battlefield. We were terrified of them. Well, I had nowhere to go, and so I asked them to take me as their prisoner. They just laughed. I could tell that they intended to kill me. So I asked them, I said, could I pray first? I was so surprised when they said yes. So I knelt there on that ground. How do you pray? What do you pray? Well, you're pretty sure you're about to face a brutal death. Well, I prayed a prayer probably much like what you would pray. I just started praying out loud. I said, God, please receive my soul, which is about to come to you. Watch over my family, my church. God, help us to win this fight. We've got to win this fight. Well, it was about then that I remembered the words of Jesus. You remember when Jesus on the cross asked the Father not to blame those around him for his death? I just prayed it out loud. Those Hessians had moved in very close for the kill. And I said, God, please do not blame these men with my death. Now, you would think that that would have melted those old cold, hard Hessian hearts. But it didn't. Sadly, it didn't even make a dent. As soon as I finished that prayer, the British commander in charge of those men said, take him. And they jumped on me and they began to bayonet me to death with such rage and fury that when my body was found later, one of the Hessians had left the bayonet in my body and had broken it off in anger. A black robed preacher by the name of George Duffield and my wife and her brother gave my body a Christian burial where I await the resurrection in Trenton, New Jersey today. You see, when we rode off to fight for liberty, we knew that some of us would most likely be wounded. We even figured that some of us would probably be killed. But we just pushed that out of our minds. You know, you don't want to think about that. But I'm here to tell you that many preachers gave their lives for your liberty. Many men and women in their churches. You know, I often ask people, if my generation of Christians was willing to die for liberty, is it too much to ask your generation to stand up and speak out for it? Is that too much? Too much. Friends, today we have heard amazing stories, stories about John Rosbrug, Joab Trout, the young preacher that preached that amazing sermon at Brandywine, James and Hannah Caldwell, who gave their lives for the cause, the 8 Minutemen of preacher Jonas Clark in Lexington, Samuel McClintock out of New Hampshire, his 3 sons died for liberty. We have Charles Thompson, the Baptist preacher, on a prison ship. Even the president of Yale, Naftali Daggett. Men and women like those died for our liberties. And they were church leaders, Christians. What are we going to do? This is why my wife and I, even though I'm a full-time pastor, even when I was serving in the legislature, now I'm running for governor, we travel all over the state, all over the country, sharing this story. We must bring back the spirit of the black-robed regiment. If we don't, who will stand? If we don't, who will? In fact, I'm praying that God will do that today. Would you join me in this prayer? Let's just bow our heads. And while I'm praying, I'm going to ask you to ask the Lord, God, what should I do? Some of you actually ought to run for office, whether that would be city council, school board, a county office. Maybe some of you ought to run for the legislature. But whatever it is God wants you to do, I'm going to ask you to listen to Him. Father, in Jesus' name we come to you and we thank you for the liberty that we've received. God, today we pray that you'd stir up our hearts. Forgive us for not standing like we ought to stand. We're Christians. We need to stand. Help us to stand for spiritual truths, for liberty, for truth in general. And Lord, I pray that you'd raise up a new generation of preachers and Christians who will lead the way. Convict every one of us, Lord. There's a job that all of us can do. And Lord, to use the words of Joab Trout from September the 10th, 1777, Lord, please prosper the cause. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you so much for allowing me to bring the story of the Black Robe Regiment to Mountain Movers Church. God bless you as we all stand together for liberty. Thank you today for being here. God bless you. Thank you. Thank you.
Hey, thanks for joining us today. We sincerely hope the message impacted your life. Stay connected with us by following us online, or you can find us on Facebook. If you would like to partner with us financially, we have a few easy ways to give. You can text your giving to 77977 and simply type in MMC and follow the prompts. Or you could find us online at www.mountainmoverschurch.org and click the Give Now tab. Or you could simply mail your giving in to 24000 South 660 Road, Grove, Oklahoma, 74344. We are a church leading people into a real and life-changing relationship with Jesus Christ that is contagious. We look forward to seeing you next week.